Siddha sir, I'll start with you because your shift has been from print to digital and that too from a print publication like Hindu to the Wire.
Right.
A challenging thing to form a website and then take it to the levels of success.
Yeah.
Is it really paying off?
Okay.
You make your initial remarks, then we'll go for the nitty-gritty stuff.
Yeah. I mean, I'll before entering into the mechanics of the Wire or whether it's paying off, I thought I would spend a few minutes just to explain why I, as a journalist and editor, am excited about the digital future of the media, and I'm convinced that the media's future is digital, and that's a good thing for me, I suppose, as a digital player, pure digital player. But the problem is that everyone is a player, potentially. So when we speak of digital, you are not just talking of standalone websites like The Wire, but every legacy media, whether print or television, is itself a digital player. It's a different matter that they perhaps don't know how to think digitally, or they don't think digital first. And a lot of the approach that we see newspapers or even TV channels, although I have to say TV channels are perhaps more digitally oriented than newspapers, but I would say most TV and newspaper editors, proprietors, and platforms are still prisoners of their legacy format. And this affects the way in which they cover a story, it affects the way in which they treat with issues as they arise, makes them less flexible, more rigid, and for that reason, a space exists for digital platforms to come into being and to thrive. That said, I am acutely aware that the website I run, along with my colleagues, is part of one media ecosystem, one news cycle system, if you will, where TV and newspapers, social media, and independent digital platforms all coexist, occupy different slots, they feed off each other. If you look at the news cycle through the day, when I used to edit The Hindu, by evening, most of my news editors, apart from looking at story lists that would come in from bureaus from around the country, would, without fail, before coming for the evening meeting, have a sense of what are the top stories that TV channels are running. We used to criticize them for this because we said, don't be slaves of the news judgment of television, and television often makes very bad news judgments, so do newspapers, but it was clear to me that this was an illness, a malaise that I could not accept. Is wedded to checking TV channels at night, just like I am told reliably, TV news editors wake up in the morning with trepidation to look at the day's headlines and figure out what story they've missed, or in some cases, what stories they can chase. And as the day develops, TV channels run certain stories that perhaps a newspaper broke. If they don't do it well enough, you have websites that are doing that job. Often websites create enough noise around a story during the day that by evening, both print and TV news editors start picking up those stories. And at one level, this is the way, this is the media, this is the way we all exist. We also need to be aware, however, that every medium, creates a different mode of storytelling. So the typical newspaper story was very much a product of the nature of the newspaper, the fact that you had physical pages that required typesetting at one point, which was done mechanically. Then, of course, you had computer typesetting. But the mode of production of a newspaper impacted the way stories were reported. That began to change when television came into being, because there were new dynamics in the way a story could be covered. And of course, that change has changed even more dramatically with the advent of digital. But I want to emphasize that just like every medium creates a different mode of storytelling, those modes of telling stories also have an impact on the stories themselves. And I think the role that media plays in shaping events, shaping news, I wouldn't say creating news, although sometimes news events can be created, and I don't necessarily mean in the sense of fabricating an event, although we have examples of that too, and we can talk about it. But the role, media, the ability of media to play, to decide, for example, on the basis of one grainy video clip that came in of Dudhan Maji carrying the body of his deceased wife in Orissa because there weren't any ambulances. There were news editors who decided that we are going to make a story out of this. And that was a very important, that was a powerful tool that they had in their hands. When TV channels said, isko dikhao, isko chalao. And when websites began to make a noise about it, newspapers then picked it up the next day. It's a different matter that I'm not comfortable with a story like this being the product of pure coincidence or happenstance. In other words, did we in the media really need the happy coincidence of somebody with a phone camera being around when this unfortunate gentleman is carrying his deceased wife in order for us to realize that there are no ambulance services for the poor? This is a story that we should have been all over for many years. And this brings me to the arguably the most important point I want to make about digital, and which is that this is really, digital has to guard against the problems that are afflicting legacy media, and the fundamental question is, who is going to report the news? This is the fundamental basis of any news organization, has to be finding out what's happening, presenting it to readers or viewers. But how committed are we as media organizations to news gathering? How much money are we willing to spend? How many resources are we willing to devote? How many enemies are we prepared to make in chasing a particular kind of story? Unfortunately, we've seen over the years, and this trend has become accentuated, I dare say, in the last decade or so, greater unwillingness of newspapers and TV channels to spend the kind of money that's needed to be spent on gathering important stories. The example I love to cite is in 2014, when there was this horrible case of women, perhaps more than 20 women, dying of botched up sterilization operations in a camp in Chhattisgarh. And I was talking to a friend who worked for the Hindi channel, and I said, how come this is not playing on your channel? And you're showing just one or two photographs, there's no visuals. And he says, well, what do we do? There aren't any visuals. I said, well, how come you haven't sent a team to get those visuals? And he says, management doesn't want to spend money. And 1 week later, the same management was quite happy to send a crew of four to cover the Madison Square Garden rally of Mr. Modi. So media houses are making choices about where they want to deploy their funds, and in doing so are defining, perhaps in an artificial way, what is news and what's not news. And I think that to a large extent, this is a product of the financial, the political economy of the media, the financial, the business model, and in the discussion, I'm happy to share my thoughts on why I feel the business model of media is breaking down, perhaps has already broken down, and is leading to all kinds of perversions in terms of the definition of what constitutes news. But the bottom line is that in a media enterprise or industry where advertising is supposed to pay for news gathering, right? Mota mota. will a digital world be able to sustain, will it generate advertising revenue on a scale that can cover the news gathering expenses? And this is a question that I worry about. And if it doesn't, then what's the answer to this? We see a lot of digital startups. There's perhaps every day 5 new sites open up. None of them is interested in generating or creating original content. So the name of the game is packaging, repackaging. We've come up with this cute word called curation. I'm sure many of you are familiar with the idea of curation. So you HTML story aa gaya usko redo karke chep do, right? But no, it's, I mean, these are important things to do also. HT may have a great story. It should be presented to a wider audience. But if all that digital is going to do is feed off what mainstream media is doing, or print and audiovisual media is doing, and if those legacy media brands are investing less and less in news, then I foresee a system where quite a large number of media organizations, including the majority of digital ventures, will be scrambling to cover and recover and package and repackage a shrinking pool of content. And Bhupendra is right about the importance of citizen journalism. So that may provide some kind of an answer. That video of Dudhan Maji is citizen journalism at one level. But there's a limit to that, because in the absence of editorial direction, leadership, and essentially, somebody making those difficult calls on what, how you want to treat a particular kind of story. And a lot of journalism is precisely that. Editors make difficult calls about a story that is unfolding, and they make judgments on the resources they want to devote to covering that story. So citizen journalism can never be a substitute to that. And the danger I foresee is that when there's not enough news to curate from existing news sources, if media is going to increasingly rely on quote-unquote citizen journalism to fill the void, this means that there will be a further slippage in editorial standards as far as verification of stories. As it is, we know that lots of fake content circulates on the internet. And it's a very, very dangerous thing for an editor to do, to rely, photographs are morphed, all kinds of fabrication. Some of it innocent and people creating a joke. A lot of it is politically driven. And if one is going to rely on stuff whose provenance you don't know about, videos that appear mysteriously and we don't know who shot this video and why, I think this is a very, very dicey situation for us to go into. And I think these are some of the pitfalls of this digital future of ours, that it's leveled the playing field in a way. If I have a good story on the wire.in, it has every chance of reaching the same number of readers as a story that appears on Indian Express or the Times of India. The newspapers have that one-day advantage where a printed product goes in the hands of a reader, but we don't know how many of them actually read the story. There's no way of knowing that. The internet gives us very hard metrics about how many people have read a story, how much time do they spend, what do they do after reading that story. And we know from experience that the field is fairly level. And good journalism, even from a small organization, can actually reach a very, very large number of people. So that's the positive aspect of the digital future that we're going into. But unless we have an answer to the fact that the business model of news gathering and news presentation has broken down, and if it has broken down, then what's the answer? Unless we have a conversation or a discussion on this. We've attempted some answers at The Wire, and I'll be happy to share my views on this in the discussion. But I think any discussion on the future of digital that does not look at the political economy of media will necessarily be a very limiting one. So I'll stop there.
Yeah. Okay, we'll go into the business models and things later. So there are two aspects to this topic. One is whether digital will be the mainstream. And second, if it becomes mainstream, will it lead to more independent journalism? Now, let's deal with the first aspect. Can it be the mainstream? And if it becomes mainstream, what are the advantages and what are the pitfalls?
Pramod, first of all, to wish all your viewers at Prudent congratulations for completing 10 years. And the very fact that Goa has 5 24/7 news channels is itself a sign that, you know, contrary to what we all think, TV is not dead and is not going anywhere. I think the question that we have to ask is, what is mainstream in the first instance? Is it that mainstream is defined by the large volumes that, say, a newspaper like the Times of India has, or the large volumes that a TV channel like Aaj Tak would have, just the sheer number of people who would either read or view it? Is that mainstream? Or is mainstream defined by the content that you put out? And does content define whether you are mainstream, or does the medium in which you are define whether you are mainstream or not? Let's be clear. In my view, we are still 4 or 5 years away from where any Hindi website today will get the reach of an Aaj Tak, in just terms of sheer eyeballs and the number of people who will tune in to an Aaj Tak news channel. I think we are still 4 to 5 years comparing a Hindi website to an Aaj Tak. On the other hand, it is undoubtedly true that there is a huge space out there for people who would like to hear narratives that you will never see on an Aaj Tak, on a digital site which is in Hindi. Similarly, you would like to see stuff which you will never probably see today in a Times of India, which you would like to see and analyze possibly on a website. Does that make that website alternative, or does that make, is the fact that the medium is defining whether you are mainstream or not? To my mind, there are a lot of digital sites which could claim justifiably to some extent that they too are part of the mainstream today. That there are people, there is a generation today which is growing up, which looks at digital as possibly what is mainstream for them. The younger Indian is increasingly turning possibly to digital as an important source of news. You know, I've been doing this news quiz program, and I go to schools to tell them about news. And I was very interested, most of them today, when I ask them, where do you get your news? They say they get their news from a thing called News in Shorts. It's a website which essentially gives every story in 50 words. And they say that is where we turn to for news. These are 10th, 11th, 12th standard students. None of them watch TV, or very few of them told me they watch TV as appointment viewing. He at 9 o'clock, I will forget everything else in the world and watch TV. There are very few who tell me that. There are few of them who tell me that I read the front page of the Times of India or the Hindu every day. Very few. So obviously there is some change already generationally that is already taking place in this country, wherein digital is slowly coming into the lives of people in more ways. There is obviously the problem, though, that while eyeballs are shifting, revenues are not. Mm-hmm. So revenues today still remain very much in print and television. If you look at the revenue that a Times of India makes, or the revenues that an Aaj Tak would probably make, I'm using these two as because they're probably the most successful in terms of their revenues, in terms of TV and print. No digital site, I think, in the next 5 years can compete with those revenues. That is a harsh reality. And therefore, if you are looking at digital as the alternative to newspapers and TV, you have to find what is the revenue model that will enable them to sustain the kind of news gathering that you will need to compete with possibly these two big behemoths that exist. So I think, yes, in terms of audiences, there is a mainstream nature of digital that is already taking place. It may not be seen dramatically, but it's silently taking place. Whether it will be able to compete in revenue terms or even in terms of impact with a television channel, let's say there is a breaking news of a surgical strike which India has taken on Pakistan, the breaking news will first come, whether you like it or not. Possibly people will switch on their TV channels first. and will also read the newspaper next day. They will turn to digital as well, possibly. But their first outlook will be the TV channel even today. I think the key question is not about what is mainstream and what is not. The key question is how do you maintain independence? How do you create today platforms that are truly independent? What is the definition of independence? In my view, today there are about maximum 5 to 6 news networks, and I include newspaper, TV in all this, who can claim that their core business is journalism. There may be even fewer than that. In terms of the owners of news channels or newspapers, I doubt there are, even today, some of the leading Hindi newspapers, for example, their owners are owning power plants. Somebody now, you know, India's largest newspaper chain is starting an has started education institutes, where you have to get the chief minister of Uttar Pradesh there to bless it so that it can move faster, land is acquired faster. So even when the largest newspaper chain in this country believes that their future in terms of money, despite all the money they are making from journalism, they still need to set up an education institute. When the largest Hindi newspaper in the country, their owners have decided we also want power plants. When a network today acquires a regional network and then decides, and their owner is in constant communication with the government of the day because of regulatory issues, how do you expect that channel or that newspaper to be remotely independent? It cannot be, not in the classical sense. There will be conflict of interest. Can a Network 18 report independently on the petroleum sector? It cannot. By its very nature, it cannot. Can that Hindi newspaper, which has a power plant, report on the power plant of the Madhya Pradesh government? It cannot. By its very nature, it cannot. Can UP elections are coming out? Can India's largest newspaper, which has taken benefits from the Uttar Pradesh government, can it really take on the Uttar Pradesh government? It may take it on when it knows the government is losing. That's when it will take it on, not in the build-up, not today. How do I then create what is a truly independent? As I said, I believe there are 2.5. There are exactly 2.5 proprietors today who I can say their core interest is journalism. They want to make their money through journalism. But even they have to make compromises today. Because even they believe that unless I'm on the right side of the government, I may not necessarily get the kind of advertising support I need. Or I might not, I have to invite tomorrow the Prime Minister for a function, let us say. Suppose Prudent wanted to invite the Chief Minister of Goa for this function today. Can you the day before that expose the Goa Chief Minister? You cannot. You will not be, he will not come for your function. He may, Parsekar is a nice man. Would Narendra Modi ever come? If you expose Narendra Modi tomorrow, would he come for your function? He will not. And you want him for your function because your advertiser has said, this is a 3 crore property, but I will only give you the money if the Prime Minister is there at the function. So all the boundaries that existed between business houses and the newsroom have broken down across the board. Why blame any one person? It's happening across the board. So independence is the critical question. I mean, in that scenario where independence is being compromised, can digital fill in that vacuum? Because the cost or the general cost of production of a digital news site is possibly much lesser certainly than a TV news channel, and is also lesser than bringing out a newspaper. So unless we are able to find in print and TV a business model which will allow us to retain our independence and be a true public service broadcaster, I think print and TV, you can forget their ability to be truly independent. Because digital is new, digital perhaps offers the hope that it can create, maybe you can expose, you can do an expose on digital without the fear that tomorrow the Chief Minister or the Prime Minister or whichever party is in power will close down your site. Now you cannot do that today in television. You have an election taking place in Punjab in a few months. No channel today can do a story in Punjab exposing the Akali Dal because the Akali Dal controls cable. As a result, the moment you do a story against them, your channel will be switched off. Now, the tragedy is the channels, instead of coming together and fighting this, have almost conceded it, have almost accepted it, that in Punjab we cannot do a story today against the Akali Dal. So, my fear is that we have all accepted the happy unhappy situation we are in. And we have said, chalo, what can we do? How do we change it? We live in our own small space, and within that small space, we try and do whatever is possible. Or, as Siddharth has attempted, you take a trust model and try and build an alternative media in web. He's a very brave man to do that, and I full credit to him. But you will need many more like that. And that cannot become the basis, a template for all future media. Because eventually media also needs money. Media, whether you like it or not, needs advertising support. How else will you sustain? You have five news channels in Goa today. Can those five news channels today, beyond a point, sustain given the size of Goa's economy? Can they sustain the kind of advertising support? So you have now elections coming up in Goa. The pressure will be on all five of you, there are politicians here, to do what you call paid news. Let's be honest. Every party will come to you, you give me a half an hour program on my candidate, and I will pay you so much. And whether we like it or not, at least two of them, of the five, will succumb. Because your business model, elections is a business model also. You have created a business model of paid news around elections. The politician knows it, you know it. Who's going to challenge it and say, no, we will not accept it? It's not going to happen. So, I think unless we are clear about the fact that A, there is a crisis when it comes to independence. B, we are running out of solutions to combat the crisis, at least as far as big media goes. To start a television channel today in this country, the kind of money, the kind of investment you need, who are the people who are ready to invest in it? Most of them who are ready to invest in it are those who have no concern about journalism. They either want influence, power, or they believe that this will give them some kind of a respectability that they otherwise will not get in the media. That's the reality. Now, given this reality, maybe digital, because of the low-cost model, will perhaps be the alternative. It will not replace TV, it will not replace print, but it will create for itself possibly some small space. And hopefully over time it will challenge these top channels. My worry though is that digital also, like TV in particular, and to some extent print, is also sometimes sensationalizing. And I don't know what is the level of due diligence. One website put out 10 days ago that 20 Indian soldiers had crossed the border. And they had killed, Indian soldiers had crossed the border, killed 20 terrorists. Nobody knows where that story came from. But for that day, they must have got hits because it was a sensational story. Even this story of Maji, this story of Odisha, it is now turning out is very different to what it was. The person who shot the story actually made that person carry that child and then sold the story to 10 channels across India to make money. It was not as if the ambulance was not available. Ambulance was brought eventually. It came late. But that guy realized that if I make this person, I will make a story out of it. And because it is in Odisha, in the deep Kalahandi, nobody is going to do due diligence. I see the picture, I say, achha story hai, sensationalize karo. So the tendency to sensationalize is not going to change because of digital. In fact, my worry is because of the mad competition in digital, there will be even crazier thing done in digital than on TV. Because you have to get the video to go viral. It's not enough to put out a video. Video has to go viral. Even column has to go viral. To go viral, you have to say something stupid or sensational at times. We are replacing sense by sensation across media. So I think we are a long way away from solving the independence problem of the media today. How do you create an independent media in a country whose political economy, if we use the word that Siddharth used, political economy is today driven by interests that are so intertwined between the state and the corporate world, or between state and specific special interest groups. How are we going to break it? Citizen journalism is not the answer. Citizen journalism can be only one small thing that you can do. It cannot change India. I think the change will come only if I think some kind of journalism which regional networks could do if they could find a low-cost model. If there is a low-cost model of doing any form of journalism, you use iPhones now instead of the big cameras. You don't use OB vans. Now you use live views or you use Skype machines to put out. You'll have to find a low-cost model or you will have to do crowdsourcing. Why is it that in a country of so many millionaires, and I am convinced now about it, if Ashoka University can come up in Delhi through good funding of good people, why can good media not come out where 10 Indians say, I am willing to put 50 crores each? 10 top Indians say, I am willing to put 50 crores each to back a public sector, public service broadcaster. I don't see why that cannot happen. India will have enough wealthy people who, according to me, will at some stage in the next 5 or 10 years say, I am ready to back this as a public service broadcaster. That, if it happens to my mind, or a website which will have that kind of, with less money, but will be backed by individuals of credibility. If we can create a trust model or a public service broadcaster model, we have hope. Corporate media in its present form, and most of mainstream media, as I said, except two to two and a half, have interests outside journalism, is not going to be able to create independent media.
That is a very interesting. One of the senior most editors once said, editor should judge whether he is 51% independent or 49% independent. And if you are 51% independent, you can be happy. And if you are 49% independent, you can be unhappy. How do you rate this independence into these percentages? That is it 100% independence that's required, come what may, or it can be 90% or 80%? Okay. So I know it's a very funny question, but yeah. No, in today's age, I have to ask that question.
You know, I wouldn't put it in mathematical terms like that.
Mm.
The way I would phrase what you're saying, or what perhaps this editor is getting at, is that even an independent editor has to know which battles she wants to fight and which ones are not worth fighting, right? So editing a newspaper or a website or a TV channel, being the editor of a TV channel, involves, you have to have political smarts, right? So the name of the game is that how can you be true to your viewers and readers, to the wider body politic to whom you ultimately are answerable or that you believe you're serving, while at the same time generating enough revenue and, if possible, having enough goodwill with the people that you write about so that they don't fully boycott you or, worse, target you. Right? Broadly speaking, this is the world in which an independent editor operates, right? So, unfortunately, so here you may decide, like, you know, Bhupendra Chaubey gave the example that he wants to interview, you want somebody's interview, so you know you may report a story. That person whose interview you want may want to put out a certain story about how his constituency is doing great. So, wo kahin raat ko chala ke daba diya. You know, people make these kinds of calls, and you know, for me, these are not major compromises because these are part of the